Trees are white with snow, and all around reminders of you are everywhere I go. In no hurry, sleep won't set me free. I lie awake and try to recall how your body felt beside me. When silence gets too hard to handle and the night too long. This is how I see you in the snow on Christmas morning. Love and happiness around you as you throw your arms up to the sky. I keep this moment by and by. Oh, how I miss you now, my love. Merry Christmas, Merry Christmas, my love. Sense of joy fills the air, and I daydream and I stare above the tree, and I see your star. This is how I see you in the snow on Christmas morning. Love and happiness around you as you throw your arms up to the sky. I keep this moment by.
Isn't that an incredible voice? Megan has sang for us right here at Raymond many times in the past, sometimes on Christmas Eve, right in front of this very piano that I'm sitting next to. We thank her for the gift that she has provided. We've watched her grow into a phenomenal young woman and mature with a voice that is just piercing and beautiful. And so we thank her for this gift. Her dad, Jim, accompanies her, and her brother, Nick, does the production on the video. And so we thank the whole Lee family for their gift that they have given to us. You have joined worship with the Raymond United Methodist Church, located in southeast Nebraska. Welcome to this place and to this time when we worship together. It's the third Sunday of Advent. We'll be lighting the candle of joy or the candle of love if you're following along with our Advent wreath. And we're glad that you are here this morning. I pray that your connection and your love with God will grow as you worship with us this morning. Kids, we're going to be talking about what happens in the classroom when the teacher steps out. So you can stay tuned for that in just a few minutes. That's what we're going to be talking about. I've got my coffee with me this morning in my Christmas mug, and I invite you to have coffee with you as well today as we worship together. We've got some incredible pictures for you to show from our congregation. Advent wreaths and Christmas decorations and kids. It's great. And we thank you for sending these pictures in. Enjoy these now as we as a congregation, far and wide, connect together. Thank you. It's an exciting day in the life of the church because it's the third Sunday of Advent. We get to light the third candle, which is the candle of joy or the candle of life. And it's the odd-colored candle. It's the pink one. And so you have already written in, lit in your wreaths the a couple of the white candles. Today, you have to find the one that colors pink because it's the third Sunday. Now, the question that is burning within your soul is, Pastor Rod, why is the third Sunday a different color than the others? And so I have researched this and come up with an answer for you, and that is, it's confusing. It depends on the tradition that you hold. Now, for us, with our Advent wreath on the altar, the third Sunday is designated by the different color of ornament that's hung around it. It's a pink ornament instead of a purple one. This one that has the white ornament is the Christ candle. Wreaths are sometimes put in logs that are in a row. Sometimes they're in circles. Sometimes they're white candles. Often there's three purple ones and then a pink one for the third Sunday. Perhaps you have some very strong feelings about this, but I just want you to not get your garland all wrapped up in a wad today, because people celebrate it in a lot of different ways. Now, this Sunday is known as Gaudete Sunday. Now, if you look at the word Gaudete, or at least when I look at it, because I have 4 years of French in my background, when I look at the word, I want to pronounce it Gaudete. But that's not how it's pronounced. It's Gaudete. And what it means is rejoice. And it comes to us from that fourth chapter of Philippians that we've visited recently, where it says, rejoice, rejoice in the Lord always. I tell you, rejoice. And that's where that comes from. And so there's lots of different stories. If you want some really good entertainment, just Google, why is the third Sunday a different color or is it pink or whatever it might be. And you'll get all kinds of different stories. And it depends upon different traditions of the church. Now, the Catholic denomination has put in some pretty cool traditions for this. But even for them, this tradition is only 100 years old, because they didn't start doing the Advent wreath until around 1920. And so for us as United Methodists, we certainly use the Advent wreath, but we don't get hung up on the colors so much. So today we experience the candle of joy or the candle of life in our devotional. And I'd like for us to, I'm going to use the liturgy that you have with your Advent wreath, if you've got one from us. And if not, you're welcome to join along. The first candle that we lit on the first Sunday of Advent was the candle of hope. And the second candle that we lit was the candle of peace. And today we light the pink candle, which is the candle of joy or the candle of life. Behold the gifts of God made flesh to stir the heart, the soul refresh. The presence of the Lord is known. In Bethlehem his gift is shown. Stir up the world, O God. Let the whole earth be ready for the coming of the King. Make rooms of our homes happy. Make the chambers of our hearts ready. From the shopping mall to the fine-decked hall, let us meet and greet you, Word made flesh. Dear Father, as you once called John to witness to your coming Son, send us as well to spread abroad good news, the coming of our Lord. Stir up within the hearts of your people, O God, the joy that comes with the new life you give. Let us chase toward your promise with the shepherds. Let us rejoice at the birth of heaven's love enfleshed. Enliven us to enter a morbid world. With light and light, life you gift us, Lord, eternity our great reward. Enliven thus our joy renew, that we may share these gifts from you. The Advent flames now flicker threefold, alive with the light that enlivens us. Come, Lord Jesus, come quickly. Thus present laden cause the shift that changes gifted into gift. Let your present presence be rich gifts of life for all to see. May God bless your third Advent candle, that you might experience joy this week as we prepare ourselves for the coming Christ child. Amen. Coming up in the life of our church on Monday evening, December 22nd, is a blue Christmas service. That's not online. That's going to be right here in the sanctuary. It's for those of us who are grieving the loss of someone that we love, or the loss of a job, or we're feeling bah humbug, or for some reason the Christmas spirit is full of grief for us this year. And we come together to acknowledge that. It'll be a short worship service beginning at 7 o'clock in the evening. And I invite you to come to that. Masks will be required, and we will spread out across the sanctuary, and kind of a healing type of Blue Christmas service for those that experience loss. And so I want to bring that to your attention. Now, Christmas Eve is right around the corner. It's only like 10 days away. And so there's a couple of opportunities for us there. One is that I will be serving communion here at the church, at the altar, for you and your family. But I need for you to sign up for that. So I've arranged for Ann to put us on a computer sign-up program, and you received that in your email this morning. And if not, I'll get it to you. But you can go online and sign up every 15 minutes, and so your family can come and gather around the altar and around communion, and we'll experience Christmas Eve together with communion and the specialness that provides, if that's something that you and your family would like to do. Now, the other thing is that we also have an online Christmas Eve service that we're putting together. We've already started on that. And my prayer is that it will be one that is very special and very powerful for you right out of our Raymond United Methodist Church. But one of the things that I need from you is greetings for that, to be able to express your Merry Christmas to the rest of the congregation so that we might connect together in that way. Now, I've got an example for you to watch, so take a look at this.
Merry Christmas, everybody!
Special thanks to Madison and Martin for doing those greetings for us. If you can do something similar to that and send it to us for Christmas Eve, that would be absolutely wonderful. If you can't do a video and you can only do a still shot, that's okay too. If you remember in the movie White Christmas, they arranged for all the military that was underneath that particular general to come together on Christmas Eve at the little inn up in Vermont to help him celebrate his one of the major birthdays that he had. So they left their families, they did all kinds of things to go to this Vermont Inn for this one particular person. My point is, you can probably send me a 5 or a 10 second video of Merry Christmas so that we can share that on Christmas Eve. So I hope that you'll do that for us. And you can look forward to that video to view with your family on Christmas Eve or whenever it works for you. We here at Raymond have adopted a couple of families for the Christmas season. And I have updated that list and emailed it out. Celeste is doing a great job of keeping track of who's committing to what. There are items that are left on there. If the items are too expensive for you to use, in other words, if you feel like they deserve a pair of boots that are $100 and you can't afford that, perhaps a $25 gift certificate towards that would work, and we can put those together to make some of those things happen. There is room for you to help give and to make a difference in someone's life this Christmas season. Our Friendship Home family is one that just escaped a house of abuse right before the Thanksgiving season, and so it's a single mom and two kids, and they're with the Friendship Home and safe now, and have a peaceful life together as they rebuild. But they left without taking anything with them. Teresa and her family are part of our congregation. And Teresa's brother passed away a couple months ago and left two young boys. And Teresa's taken them on to raise them. And so she has, along with her own daughter, two boys to raise now, a family of four as a single working mom. And so we're helping her out. Those items are on that sheet, and Celeste will help you. So give her a call. Even if you don't look at the sheet, you can call Celeste and say, hey, how can I help? What can I do? And she'll be glad to help you with this. We need to have the stuff by next Sunday because Christmas is right around the corner. And so we've got this week to put all this stuff together. Thank you for participating in this and for helping out. It's great that you have that we have responded in this way. This church is phenomenal for that, and I'm so proud of it. So thanks for responding that way. Remember, you can give your offering in a couple of different ways to us. One is through PayPal. On your computer, and if you have a little trouble with that, just email us and let us know. We've had that happen recently, and we'll work with you and try to guide you through that. The other way is just send us through the mail your check. It's Box 303, Raymond, Nebraska, 68428. And so thank you for your continued support of our ministry here in the little town of Raymond in this United Methodist Church. It is so appreciated. For prayer concerns this morning, we have those that are on a journey with cancer. We want to lift those up, and that's Glenn, which is Greg's uncle, and Rhonda Chubbuck. She and Gary are in Pleasant Dale now, and Rhonda is experiencing cancer. Susan Lister is a co-worker of Catherine Gertis, and she's working through breast cancer. Patty Talamante, niece of Dwayne and Sandy Reed, has been on a journey with cancer for a long time, and she's really struggling right now, lining some things up. The doctors are frustrated and really don't know what else they can do for her. There's some decisions being made. Please be in prayer for Patty as she faces the next part of her journey. Linda Shasowski from Seward is also on kind of a heavy journey with cancer. She has had surgeries, multiple surgeries, and is recovering from them right now, and she's very tender as she recovers. The cancer she has is stage 4, but the tumors that she has are the best kind that she can have. It's a slow growing. So our prayers are with her, that God will provide healing for her as well. Doug Shepherd has finally dropped the low-grade fever that he has. He is feeling better and doing better. He is a long ways from getting out of the house or being able to do anything else. But his spirits have lifted, and he's feeling a little bit better, and he's feeling the prayers for us. Send him a card or give him a call if you'd like to. He'd love to hear from you. He's home all the time. Janon Bloyd is at home recovering from COVID, and her recovery has taken a while as well. Her husband, Ron, has also been positive. I don't think his symptoms are quite as bad, but our prayers are with her as well. Hudson, who is 6 years old, has brain cancer, is on hospice. And that's a friend of Leanne Lowther, and we ask for prayers for Hudson. Also, because Joanne Miller just passed away a couple weeks ago, I would ask for prayers for her husband, Don, because he's certainly suffering from grief and is floundering in life, and just ask that he might feel God's presence with him, and that we might pray for him and lift him up in support. If you have other prayer concerns for me, please give me a call, send me a text. I'd be glad to deal with them in an appropriate way. I love hearing from you, and although I don't always love hearing about the issues we have in life, I care and I want to know. So thanks for being with us through this. Here's a video that you can enjoy that we kind of put together special for today. Okay, kids, when you're in school and you're studying at your desk in the classroom, and the teacher has given you an assignment to work on, and then she needs to slip out for a little bit to do something in the office, and so she leaves you alone, what happens in the classroom when she slips out? Now, I'm not really sure what happens in your classroom, but I can just tell you that I remember what happened in some of my classrooms, because that's when we started wadding up papers into spitballs and throwing them at each other, and that's when people got up and started acting goofy, and they were writing things on the chalkboard and doing all kinds of things they weren't supposed to be doing because the teacher was gone. And then all of a sudden there would be this announcement that here she comes, she's coming back. Sometimes there was someone posted at the door looking down the hallway to see when she comes back. Other times we could hear the footsteps coming down the hallway, but there was this announcement, here she comes, here she comes, and everybody would rush back to their desk and they would get down and they'd be working and everything would be just as quiet and serene as can be when she stepped in through the door, like nothing ever happened. That's pretty important to have that announcement, isn't it, that she's coming back so that nobody gets into trouble. When you get to a train track and the gates come down, those bars come down, and they have flashing lights all over them and bells are ringing, that's an announcement, isn't it? It's an announcement there's a train coming down the track and we need to be prepared, right? Just like when we're prepared for the teacher when she comes back into our classroom. On the 20th of January, there's going to be this huge celebration called an inauguration for a new president that's coming into the White House, into the presidency. And it'll be a huge affair with lots of things going on to celebrate and to announce that we have a new president and a new family in the White House. Well, today's scripture lesson is kind of like that. It's about John the Baptist. And John is the guy that comes ahead of Jesus announcing that the Son of God is coming. And so he came and was declaring to all the people by preaching and shouting and getting on soapboxes and getting a crowd around him and talking to them and saying, look, people, you need to clean up your act. Somebody's coming. You need to repent, you know, which means to say I'm sorry for whatever you've done that's been wrong, and you need to get ready for the presence of God. That's John the Baptist, and that was his job. And how would you like to have a job like that? It's a little nervous when you're the one at the door watching for the teacher, isn't it? And I'll bet it was a little bit nervous for John as he prepared people for the coming of Jesus too. And yet, that's what God called him to do. And we're glad that he did. Now, you would appreciate this dude because he was a little different. He ate wild locusts for lunch and ate honey and not the normal McDonald's stuff that you would like to have. It was kind of weird. And he wore this big coat made out of fur. He was a pretty interesting looking dude. But his role was really important and people listened to him. And it's a huge part of our scripture lesson today. So if you hear that, you know, that's what that's all about. During Advent, during this time when the Christmas tree is probably up in your living room and there are lights around and some decorations going on, we're preparing, aren't we? We're preparing for Christmas Eve, and for Christmas Day, to celebrate the birth of the Christ child. And so today we recognize John the Baptist in helping us prepare for that. If you don't have all your shopping done yet, you've got a week or 10 days to do that, to see what whatever your special friend is might like for Christmas if you're going to get him a gift. You've probably checked out yours under the tree if there's any there yet. We're preparing for Christmas. Would you pray with me this morning? Fold your hands. Repeat after me. God, help us prepare for the coming of your Christ child. Amen. Thanks, guys. It's Christmas time. I will see you again next Sunday.
Today's scripture is John 1, 6 through 8 and 19 through 28. There came a man who was sent from God. His name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning the light, so that through him all men might believe. He himself was not the light. Now this was John's testimony when the Jews of Jerusalem sent priests and Levites to ask him who he was. He did not fail to confess, but confessed freely, "I am not the Christ." They asked him, "Then who are you? Are you Elijah?" He said, "No, I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." Finally they said, "Who are you? Give us an answer to take back to those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" John replied in words of Isaiah the prophet, "I am the voice of one calling in the desert, 'Make straight the ways for the Lord.'" Now some Pharisees who had been sent questioned him, "Why then do you baptize if you are not the Christ, nor Elijah, nor a prophet?" "I baptized with water," John replied, "but among you stands one you do not know. He is the one who comes after me, the thongs of which sandals I am not worthy to untie." This all happened at Bethany on the other side of the Jordan, where John was baptizing. This is the word of God for you and I, God's people.
Special thanks to Linda this morning for reading us the scripture from the book of John that was written by John the Beloved, the disciple. And this morning's scripture is about John the Baptist, who was Jesus' cousin and came to prepare the way for Jesus. And so a special thanks to her for reading that. Now, one of the things that John the Baptist did was he told people that they needed to repent and to straighten their lives out and get things right with God. And so it is extremely appropriate this morning because I have a confession to make. I need to repent a little bit, and so I'm going to share with you this story. I've been calling Wayne Anderson on occasion. Now, Wayne is our special liaison from our church here in Raymond, Nebraska, to the Spam Factory and Museum in Austin, Minnesota. And because of him, we have this special relationship with the Spam people up there. And so I've been calling Wayne every now and then saying, "Wayne, how did you like the service?" You know, and Wayne stammers a little bit, and it's pretty obvious that he hasn't watched it. And so I've been giving him a hard time about that. Well, I texted him this week, and I just texted him, and I said, "Did you catch last Sunday's service? Because I think I mentioned your name." Now, this story is mine, right? I mean, I got a phone call in a couple hours, and exactly what happened, I don't know. According to some friends I have, it's my constitutional right that I can make up whatever I want if I believe that's what happened. So we'll go with that this morning, and I'm going to tell you what I think. Anyway, I get this phone call from Wayne, and Wayne's going, I didn't see or hear my name in the message. And I said, "Oh, well, maybe it was the one before that or a couple of weeks ago. I can't remember." And he said, "Well, I didn't see it in those either." And so I'm pretty sure before he called, he had gone through like maybe the last three worship services, which is what I was hoping he would do. And I said, "Well, gee, Wayne, maybe it's going to be next week." I forgot. And he just started laughing, and we had a great laugh together. He is such a good sport. And so I've given him a pretty hard time. And it's been fun. And so I appreciate his being a good sport about this and me being able to pick on him a little bit. He's also scheduled for cataract surgery on the 23rd, so we'll keep him in our prayers and on our mind for that will all go well. But anyway, I need to repent about that. Now, if I was Catholic, I'd probably crawl into the confessional booth and I would say, "Father, forgive me, for I have sinned," and I would confess my sins about that. That's a lot about what John the Baptist told us to do. He also told us about the coming of the light. And that's what I want to talk to you about a little bit this morning. Would you pray with me this morning? God, we pray that the words of my mouth and the feelings of our hearts and the actions of our hands would be pleasing in your sight, Almighty God, our Redeemer and our Creator. Amen. So, What Linda read for us this morning was that John is pointing us to the light, right? And so maybe you have heard on the news that coming in the very near future, and in fact it's December 21st, is going to be a great star in our sky. And what's happening is that the planet Saturn and the planet Jupiter are aligning together really, really closely so that all of their light comes together in one big blob, and it's going to appear to us like a Christmas star, or at least it's going to be a lot brighter. And now you might be, you know, it hasn't happened since, I think, the year 1226. It was the last time that actually happened. And it has to be away from the sun, because if it happens during the day and the sun's shining, then we would never be able to see it. So I'm talking about when we could actually see it from here on Earth. And the next time that it happens is going to be 2080, 60 years from now. Some of you will be able to witness that. Some of us won't be around for that. So it might be important that this date on the 21st, which is a week from tomorrow, that we might pay attention to that. It's for a short period of time, like 30 minutes after sundown. And so we'll have to, in the southwest part of the sky, we're going to have to pay attention to that and watch for that, because it'll be a great thing. Now, you might be asking, Pastor Rod, how did the two planets come together and not destroy each other? Well, for us, the planet Jupiter is about a half a billion miles away from us. And that's the brightest planet of the two, and it has moons around it and stuff. And then the planet Saturn is twice that far away from us. But they just happen to be lining up so that the light lines up like if we were looking through them with a rifle scope, and just the ones a farther distance away. But the light will come shining through. And for us as Christians, as we prepare for the Christmas season, one of the things that we prepare for, that we pray for, that we pay attention to, and that we hope for is the light of Christ to shine through. There are lights all around us. Christmas lights are everywhere. We have our houses decorated. We have our trees decorated. We have lights that shine on our nativity scenes. We have lights all over the place. Our Advent wreath, the closer we get to Christmas, the more candles are lit and the brighter the light becomes as we get close to the birth of Jesus. Now, we all know how important light is. Think about what it would be like if you were a first responder during a hurricane in the middle of the night when all the electricity is out and the rain is pouring down and the wind is blowing and you need to go out and rescue someone in their home. And you're wading through the murky water into someone's home that you've never been in before and you don't know where you're going and there's no light. Think what that might be like. You'd be lost in the darkness, trying to find the person that needs to be rescued. And is that not how we sometimes feel when we lose someone that we love, that is very close to us? When we go through a divorce and life falls in around us. When we experience cancer or a disease that threatens our very life and our very souls. The darkness kind of comes in around us. And is that not true also for a pandemic? Now, a month ago, when numbers were increasing and there was no light on the horizon, no hope for our future, we couldn't hear about anything, things seemed pretty dark and pretty grim. And now all of a sudden, we have talk of a vaccine and there's a light on the horizon and there's hope in our lives. And we're grateful for that. The light is coming. God knows that we are a people that need light. We need it to live. We need it to work. We need it to function. We need it to feel alive. Light for us is hope. It's life itself. It's the very essence of our lives. And for us as Christians, it's more than a simple vaccine. It's more than a couple of planets coming together to produce this brightness. It's more than the end of a deadly disease. You know, for us, light in Jesus is an eternal promise that goes on forever. It's a promise of hope and a vow of the presence of God with us no matter what happens ever. It's that hope that we always have, and it's that joy that we have that comes from within. Not the happiness necessarily, because when we're in the darkness, we may not be happy, but yet, because of God's presence with us, we have a joy no matter what happens in our lives. God's emergence into this world in the form of Jesus is one of the greatest miracles that the world has ever known. And it's a knowledge that reminds us. It reminds us that every time and in every place that God's power and the truth of His presence is with us. So my prayer for you is that not just on December 21st when we see the planets, you know, and we witness that light, but my prayer is that is that you'll be a witness to the true light, the light of Jesus, the one that promises not just a better times coming, but promises of miracles like you have never seen or experienced before. That is why we prepare for the coming of the Christ child. That's why we celebrate His birth. That is the foundation of our faith. The light in Jesus Christ. May you find it. May you feel it. May you share it in this time of preparation when the Christ child is coming. Amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face shine upon you and give you peace. And may the light that burns in your heart be the light of Christmas as we await for the coming of the Christ child. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.